Dinas, Shafram, and Dio.
It's the biggest poker tournament Europe has ever seen.
Taking place in the grandest of settings.
Monte Carlo, the millionaire's playground, so where better to create a new one? Of course, some of these players are millionaires already. They've won a few bob at the tables, while others qualified online for just a few dollars. They're all equal at the poker tables.
But someone will walk away with over 2 million euros.
They've been playing for 3 days already.
And today, the TV cameras start rolling.
On the best poker this side of Vegas. After 3 long and hard days' play, just 39 players remain here in Monte Carlo. So what's the strategy for today?
Well, I'm the chip leader, and I like to say that I play a little more aggressive. So, you know, since I have some short stacks and some medium stacks at my table, I'm definitely going to keep the pressure on. I'm not just going to sit there.
But Antonio's going to have to get past a world champion.
I usually just take it one day at a time and set my goals small steps rather than large steps. EPT Grand Final is always one of the best tournaments around, and we're in wonderful surroundings and playing for like nearly $3 million, so not bad.
We'll be heading over to our first feature table shortly, but before the action begins, let's take a look at the tournament so far. A record 842 players entered, paying the buy-in of 10,000 euros. That means the prize pool is over 8.4 million. And the top 80 players cash. Only one player walks away with the staggering first prize, just over 2 million euros, and of course the title Champion of Europe. We've seen a veritable who's who of Hold'em this week, but for many, they now just get to watch from the rails. Only 39 players remain, and on the outer tables, we'll be looking out for Johnny Lodden, Robin Keston, and Antonio Esfandiari, all in commanding chip positions. At our feature table, we've got Luca Pagano up against Freddie Deeb. So some great players at our feature table, and a great player sitting alongside me in the commentary box, an EPT title holder, Vicky Corrin, welcome.
Thank you very much.
So Luca and Freddie are the ones to look out for, but we can't discount the likes of Anders Berg, Michael Martin.
No, there's some really good players on this table.
So Luca, of course, everyone is now in the money. 38,000 for the next player out. The winner gets just over 2 million euros. Why isn't he wearing his shirt? I like it when he wears his loud shirts.
Oh, I think they all should. I like a nice suit and tie at the poker table. Not for me, but on my fellow players.
What's the short stack? About 100 there?
He's eyeing up the chips.
It's all right. The one about 16,000.
Of Vincent Sechet, who is 16, our short 000. Stack.
Michael Pass.
He's got a hand of sorts.
Look at that, trying to get a read on old Danny DeVito over there.
Vincent from small blind,
he's moved all in.
How big blind pass.
I don't really think it matters how much it is, Freddie. You're not going to call with 10-5 of hearts.
Oh, no, he might have to. He might be priced in to call. He's hoping not. It'll be so embarrassing to turn this over, the 10-5.
You speak English?
Just a little bit.
You have a flight to catch? It's the first hand, man.
The raise is another 76,000.
Freddie doesn't have that much.
Oh, that's why you need to double up. How about if you go broke?
Well, he's getting a decent price. He might actually call this.
76.
Problem is, he'll be crippling himself if he does.
Okay, good hand.
Ready pass, wins and wins.
Freddie following his own advice. It is the first hand. By
50,
the way,
50.
It wasn't 50-50. If you're wondering why Vincent Sechet is wearing a dressing gown, he actually spent the first night here in Monte Carlo in a tent.
Might be lying too.
He then got put up in a hotel by the sponsors. And as a sign of
TV, right?
gratitude, he's wearing the hotel's bathrobe.
I thought maybe he's got a flight.
You're kind of the opposite of most poker players. You start off in an expensive hotel and end up in a tent.
So the overnight redraw has given us 39 players spread over five tables. The field features some familiar names. On table number one is South Africa's Raymond Rame, who took home $3 million for his third place finish in the 2007 World Series of Poker. To his left, the enigma that is Norway's Johnny Lodden. He's aggressive. Just a bit. Table two features a Pagano, not Luca, but his dad Claudio. We've seen him at a couple of EPT events before. This is the first time he's cashed. The magician, the current tournament chip leader, Antonio Esfandiari, is in the eighth seat. Table three features the man running second in the chip count, England's Robin Keston, and next to him in seat one, Norway's Øyvind Risum, fourth in the WSOP Europe 2007. Other side of the dealer is Isaac Barron, Car Player Magazine's Online Player of the Year. Table four, the one and only Joe Hashem. He's in the one seat, looking to win poker's coveted triple crown. That's a WPT title, a WSOP title, and an EPT title. Canada's Maxime Villemur is the table's chip leader. And rounding off the field, our featured table. Now, Deeb, Martin, Sechet and Berg all have in the region of 100,000, so they need to get busy. Blinds are at 3 and 6, and are due to go up to 4 and 8 soon. So this should make interesting viewing. And over on the outer tables, former Swedish international footballer Thomas Brolin is already on his way out of the tournament. His ace-king has been cracked by Antonio Esfandiari's ace-queen. This is revenge, Brolin, for Euro 92. It's his first EPT cash. We've seen a number of sports players turn to poker. Of course, Boris Becker was here in Monte Carlo as well.
Yeah, it was very exciting to see Boris Becker.
Jonathan Pass.
I nearly invited him into the cupboard, but he was in a hurry to get to the table.
Thomas Pass.
It's interesting, actually, to see Boris, because usually it's the snooker players and the darts players that turn to poker.
Pass.
The ones from the more...
The sports that aren't really sports.
I guess. But...
Michael Pass.
Now they're all doing it. My mother will be playing
Vincent
poker next.
Pass.
God forbid.
It's been folded round to the blinds. Anders Berg here from Norway. In the small blind.
Anders call.
The flat call with the queen seven. Luca with the ace five.
Okay.
Says,
check.
I'll see a free flop.
Up comes ace of spades.
He's hit his ace.
Queen of hearts, three of diamonds.
He's an online pro, Anders Berg. You don't often see him at these live final tables, but chopping it up online.
Ben.
Plays online as Donald.
Ben.
He's a big Donald Duck fan, apparently. Ben.
Right?
Yeah. He's got a PhD in enumerative algebraic geometry. I mean, who hasn't? But
I'm still waiting for mine to arrive in the post.
Turn cards, seven
oh.
of
hearts. Oh.
Anders moves in front, two pairs now.
Oh, poor Luca, this just looks Anders so check. Like a blank.
It went check, bet, call on the flop.
Luca bet 40,000.
Anders checks again on the turn. Luca making a sizable bet.
What might be good for Luca is that he's got such a small kicker. If he had something like ace-jack, there'd be no escaping. But he's got to figure that he's up against a bigger ace.
Anders Berg all in for 71,500. Oh, I think Luca's probably committed to this. I didn't realise Anders was that short stacked.
Looks like 31,500.
Well, he's asking for the count. I think he knows his hand's no good now.
Just leave it. Okay, 31,500.
Leave it there.
Okay, I go.
Luca call.
Yeah,
Anders
he's forced to
Berg
call for the price, but he knows it's
ace
horrible.
Queen, tray seven, showdown. Queen so seven, sick. Two pairs for Anders. So
sick.
Luca shows
it.
Ace five. You got one Ooh. Pair, aces.
No, Luca's not dead.
Ace a three or a five.
Yes.
And there's a three on the river.
Luca makes two pair, aces and trace,
wow.
And Anders Berg is our next player up.
Anders Berg counterfeited. What a horrible way to go out.
Yeah, aces and threes beats queens and sevens. Luca smiles. Anders Berg, ever the gentleman, shakes the hand of the man who took him out of the tournament.
Okay, man.
Yeah.
Bad luck. Next time.
Down to 36 players now, and we have Joe Hashem joining our feature table.
Wearing red today, Freddy.
Oh, he spotted his opposition.
Is he behaving himself?
Yeah.
Kind of.
Very well.
How can you wear a jumper under these lights, man?
How?
That's a good question, Joe. Oh. Joe famously won the 2005 World Series of Poker main event. He also took the WPT Five Diamonds title in 2006. He's got a lot of dollars to his name. Blinds currently 3,000 and 6,000, running ante of 500.
Thomas raised to 16,000. Ready pass.
Thomas Berkoff on this hand, raising with ace 10 of spades. Folded around to Joe Hashem.
So Michael pass, Vincent pass, Joe pass.
He passes from the button, so just the blinds small to get through. Pass. The big blind of Jonathan Dweck, he will call.
And big blind call, two players.
Jack nine suited, my favorite hand.
I don't really love the way this Jonathan Dweck is playing. It's kind of passive. The only time we have seen him raise from the button, he just gave it up on the flop for no bet at all. I wonder what he's going to do with this draw now.
He's got the flush draw. Berkoff's got top pair. Well, Dweck checks. Are we going to see a check raise?
Well, I think on past form, he'll probably just call. I think he's feeling a little nervous at this table, and who wouldn't? You know, they're nearing the final table, the most prestigious event in Europe. I think he's really nervous.
He's
to prove me right, he moves all in.
He's changed gears.
Yeah, I like this much better. This is really good play, because now the pressure's on Berkoff. He just doesn't want to be calling for this huge amount.
And Thomas makes the
call.
Well,
he's made the call.
Check nine of clubs. Is a flush draw.
That's an incredible call.
And ace 10 is the hand
for
Thomas.
Yeah, that is a quick call.
Jonathan,
I guess he must figure that there's too much in the pot to worry about whether he's up against ace, queen, ace, king.
And here is the turn.
Well, look, he's in front. Dweck needs to hit a club or he's out
of
here.
Of diamonds.
And just one card to come.
River card.
Oh, yeah, it's a good call from Berkoff.
It's not a club. A pair of nines is not enough against a pair of aces.
Well, I like the way Dweck played it anyway. Okay, he's got knocked out, but he's gone out like a man. He's made the move. He could have hit. He just didn't. Not his day.
34th place finish from Jonathan Dweck from Toronto. I did like his Superman hat, and I'll miss that from our feature table. His chips go across to this man from Osnabrück in Germany. He's now made it into the top eight. This is the leaderboard looking at the tournament as a whole. Antonio Esfandiari still out in front with nearly 1.2 million. Johnny Lodden still up there, as is Robin Keston. And of course, Vicky, everyone is now eyeing a seat at the final table.
Absolutely. Sometimes it's worse. In fact, it's often worse to come this far and not make the final than to go out on day one. It's one of the hardest things for non-players to understand, that a guy might finish sort of 16th and win tens of thousands of dollars, be absolutely miserable and disgusted.
Luca Pass. Pablo Pass.
An identical hand. Pablo just passed Queen 10. Thomas Berkoff is going to raise with it on the button.
Thank you.
He's the first one
Thomas
into the pot.
Raise to 21.
Ace 10 for Freddie Deeb.
Yeah, this is a re-raising hand for Freddie, I reckon.
I don't think Freddie's got many chips left, has he? They're mainly blue. They're 1,000 each.
I'm all in.
Freddie, re-raise all in.
I'm all in.
Oh,
and
dear.
Re-raise all
That's
in.
The real I'm hand. In. Yeah, as soon as a player behind goes all in, the so third Freddie all in. Mike Freddie knows that his hand's no good.
So Berkoff gets out of the way. We have a showdown, and Michael Martin of the USA is in a strong position here to eliminate Freddie Deeb. 7-3 favourite. Well, more than that now. He's hit trip jacks on the flop.
Yeah, runner-runner needed for Freddie.
So Freddie needs two cards to stay alive.
A couple of runner-runner straight draws.
Nine is not one of them.
That's it, it's all over on the turn. Freddie Deeb is out of the tournament.
He did nothing wrong there. It was the right move against the razor. It was just a monster behind him.
Nice to see Freddie shaking everyone's hand, and nice to see that Michael Martin isn't whooping and hollering and behaving like a fool.
Yeah, well brought up young man. His mother taught him poker etiquette.
Two red jacks.
And off the feature table, we've just lost Freddie Deeb. Now, you came in as one of the shorter stacks in the tournament today. How's your impression of the feature table been?
Well, it was a good table, and, you know, I just got no cards. Mm. Tried to make a few moves and it didn't work out. And there was no luck. And that's how it is sometimes.
That's just the way poker is sometimes. You have to take the good with the bad. That's what they say. But you've played a lot over here in Europe, I hear. Do you think that gave you a bit of an advantage over some of the other Americans maybe coming over and playing in Europe?
Not really. In my opinion, there is no difference where you're from and who it is are you playing against. Poker is a poker. And that's it. You know, one game. It doesn't matter who you're playing with or whether you've been here or not.
Right. You all get two cards.
The same way. You got to play the same way.
Right.
There's only one way to play poker. You got to play good and hope to get lucky.
Now we're going to be keeping our eyes on some of the other chip leaders. So thank you very much for talking to us. And well done on your cash. Thank you.
It was great. I had a good time. Beautiful place. Great food.
Thomas mm-hmm. Puss.
And lovely weather, Michael finally.
Puss. Yeah. Very. Everything is lovely.
Vincent
Look
Puss.
At you.
Oh. You. I don't know what to say to that. Thank you.
Nice. I love it that Freddie's talking about the food there. You see, people make all this fuss about poker tournaments. What should the structure be? What should the prize be? Should we add money? And for so many poker players, it's all about the buffet.
Luca calls.
It's been folded round to the blinds here. Luca Pagano just calling from the small blind. And Pablo Ubierna has 7-deuce offsuit. Renowned as the worst starting hand in Hold'em.
I like this flat call from Luca, though. The obvious thing would be to raise out of the small blind, but it's too obvious. You might get re-raised, and he wants to see a
check.
Flop with this hand,
and
he wants
flop.
To see that
check.
Flop.
10, check. Luca's
goes check.
First. He checks.
From Luca.
Of course, he must check. He's got to give the guy a chance to bluff it. And he's seen from that earlier hand that Ubierna will bluff once on the flop, and then probably give it up.
Pablo bets 15,000.
Oh, it's going to have to be the reluctant call from Luca, representing the draw.
Raise.
I know he's actually raising, or maybe
Luca's
he's frightened of the draw
raise.
Himself. I don't think he needs to. I might have just
000.
Called there with his hand.
Pablo will surely throw this away.
Yeah, he's got to throw it away. I mean, Luca's nervous that if he flat calls and it comes something like this.
All in.
Uh-oh.
Oh, my goodness.
All in and call. Pablo.
Wrong move at the wrong time. An all-in bluff, an instant call from Luca with the trip jacks. No outs for Pablo Ubierna. He's out the tournament.
Yeah, you see, this is the problem with that kind of move. I don't mind an all-in re-bluff, you know, with some kind of draw, even if it's just a middle pin. But in this situation, you know, he's completely dead if he gets called.
The wrong player is standing up. Luca, you can sit down. Pablo, you're the one who should be standing up and take a walk, buddy.
That is the sight of someone who must have been in a hurry to get back to the restaurant.
Surely there's someone playing in this tournament who actually wants to win the prize money rather than get to the buffet. And it's all been happening here in Monte Carlo. We've lost three more players. We're down to 25 already. One of those recently eliminated is Raymond Rama. His pocket queens busted by David Miara's pocket rockets. On the turn, there was the chance of a straight. He didn't get that king, though. Now, everyone thought Raymond was lucky at the World Series, but he's only played two EPTs, here and San Remo, and he's cashed in both. So let's give him some credit.
There's nothing wrong with getting lucky. If nobody did, there'd be no poker.
Blinds are up to 5,000 and 10,000, running ante of 1,000.
Luca Pass.
We're seeing some of the names of the players who haven't made it to the top 25. Including a good self, Vicky. Didn't want to rub it in, but...
Oh, well, that's comforting, just to see my name rolling past on a list of losers. Not for the first time.
Michael Rees.
Michael Martin.
To 25,000.
Not to be confused with the Speaker of the House of Commons, raising to 25,000.
Vincent Pass. Small blind Pass.
That really is a bad shirt.
Re-raise to 50,000.
Decent hand, though.
At least he's not turned up in a dressing gown.
It's a bathrobe.
Now, he hates this re-raise, Martin, and this is the thing about hands like king-queen. What people don't realise is you've got a horrible decision if you face a re-raise, so you might as well do it with five deuce. It doesn't matter. It's not a hand where you really want action. It's kind of distracting that it's two picture cards.
The thing is, Mustafa's re-raise isn't that big.
Depends what his hand is. From Martin's point of view, if the guy's got ace king,
and call,
he's just walking into a heffalump trap.
Here's the flop. Queen, three, six.
That's all come good for Martin.
So Mustafa is first.
Mustafa is first to speak.
He's unlucky here, Mustafa, because there's only the one overcard on the flop. He's got to gamble that his opponent doesn't have it.
70,000.
A raise or a call?
Yeah, it's got to be a raise. His hand isn't quite strong enough to flat call, and he certainly can't pass it.
He's moved all in.
Well, Mustafa knows he's behind now. He's going to hope that he's up against a draw. There are draws on that flop, and he may put the chips in that hope. But I think in his heart, he knows his hand is no good.
He's clearly going to take his time over this decision.
Well, this is where, if you start a hand with about 200,000, you see so much out there in the pot, you just start convincing yourself he's got the flush draw. He must do. Because you just don't want to believe the tens are no good.
Whatever he plans to do, whether it's call or fold, it'd be nice if he could do it this year.
It'll say a lot about him if he makes the pass. I think most people would feel they've just got to take the chance they're up against a draw. Given the size of the pot, you know, you want to win it. The final table is a little way away. You want to have the chips to win the tournament. If he passes, it would be the correct pass. But it might show that he doesn't have the fiery desire to take first place.
Pass, then, Michael.
He has laid it down. Michael Martin will not show the hand, but he will take the pot.
Yeah, I now don't think Mustafa Belkaute can win this. I mean, of course, if he'd made the call, he couldn't win it either because he'd have been knocked out. But I think if you can pass when there's that many chips in the pot and your hand could be good, you're not going to take first place.
During that last hand, we lost Rami Bukai in 25th place, and that means we're redrawing. Just 24 players remain. Time to change table, giving Joe the chance to catch 40 winks and giving us the chance to take a look at the current chip leaderboard. Of the 24 players remaining, these are the top eight. Some familiar names, some great players: Antonio Esfandiari, Robin Keston, and World Series of Poker winner Joe Hashem. So we're going to meet the players at our new feature table. The man who doesn't need much of an introduction is Antonio Esfandiari, the magician, currently the chip leader in the tournament with 1.6 million. Blinds still 5 and 10,000. So this is Walid Bouhabib from the Lebanon.
Walid called 10,000.
I love that. He said his weakness is that he calls too much. Look at him calling his way in on the first hand.
Stigtop Rasmussen of Denmark will fold. This will Henrik Gwimmer and Antonio Esfandiari. Action is now on Øyvind Risum.
Easy for you to say.
He's 23 years old, from Norway. Playing poker for 2 years. Likes to emulate the style of Daniel Negreanu, he says.
Øyvind raised to 34,000.
Yeah, I think Daniel Negreanu will probably raise there as well. Got to sound out this early position limp from Habib. Is it a real hand?
The big blind is Valery Ilikian from Moscow.
Big blind fold. Comes back to Valit.
He says he calls too much. Let's find out. He knows he shouldn't. He's just can't resist. I call.
At least he was telling the truth when we asked him what his weakness was.
Yeah,
what
I mean, that's not traditionally a great strength in a poker player, but it's nice in the real world.
Up comes. Eight Ooh. Of spades, nine of hearts.
Now you won't get him off it with a blunderbuss. Oh, bet it though, Habib. Don't just call. Bet out.
Four cards to the straight, but he's checking.
And check. Turn
well,
cards.
He's going to get the free turn card, actually, because Reason's checked behind.
Eight of hearts.
That's such a good scare card.
Now it looks like he is going to bet it. 52,000. Remember, the pink chips are 10,000, browns are 5,000, blues are 1,000.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Excuse me, it's 52,000. Oh, he went calls. 52,000.
Wow. What a call.
The river card.
River card is a six of
it's
diamonds.
A blank.
But he's first to speak.
Yeah, he's got to fire another bullet, Habib, but it's got to be big. You know, he's got to bet like 150,000 to have a chance. No point in betting 30.
Nine. But it bets 90,000.
Is 90,000 enough?
Now, obviously, Reason has got to think that if his hand was good on the turn, then it's good on the river. He's maybe going to make that classic mistake of changing your mind mid-hand. You know, putting somebody on something and then rethinking.
Thank you.
If he passes here, he shouldn't have called the turn. Yeah. If he's going to call the turn, he's got to call the river.
He's probably telling himself that. He's counted out the chips to make that call. They go across the line.
It's a great call.
Ace high is good.
You win.
Habib doesn't even want to show his hand.
Oivind shows ace 10.
Your Reason was loving this. There's such joy in showing a call with almost no hand. Yeah, look at this. Don't bluff me. Although he's probably thinking it in Norwegian.
While we're talking about players' weaknesses, Øyvind says his is that he's liable to tilt.
He doesn't look tilty.
Watching these players at our feature table, they include the chip leader in the tournament, Antonio Esfandiari, the magician. He's going for the triple crown, of course. He's got a World Series bracelet. He's got a WPT bracelet. He wants his first EPT title.
He looks incredibly comfortable at that table, doesn't he? I mean, that is someone who's played so much televised poker. He's got the chip lead.
Antonio Reyes.
Sitting on a cushion of happiness and
31,000. Eric Pass.
Raising him up here with the King Jack. 31,000 to play now.
Very hard for anyone to take on Esfandiari. He's got over 1.5 million in chips. He can afford to bully them. You really need a hand to take a stand.
Stig Top Rasmussen has a small pocket pair. He's in the big blind.
Big blind call.
You see, this is what I mean. He doesn't take a stand. He just calls hoping to flop a set. He's not trying to put the pressure back on, because how do you put pressure on that kind of stack?
Flop comes ace of hearts, seven of spades, seven of diamonds.
Pretty good flop for a pair.
Check, check.
Check, check on the flop. The turn card is a six.
It's so hard for Rasmussen, you know, he's so out-chipped. Esfandiari has 1 million more than him. If he bets out and gets raised, he has to pass.
Out-chipped and out of position, not the way you want to play a hand.
Yeah, he's checking to call, and Antonio knows that.
River card is a five.
Oh, now he might make a little bet. He might make a little bet, and Antonio might even think his king high is good.
Full house on the river for Rasmussen.
I'd make a big bet here if I was Rasmussen. Pot size bet. 70,000, 75,000.
Steep bet 65,000.
That's what he's done. 65,000.
Now, there's been no betting anywhere post flop.
Either have 8-9 or queen 10.
Nope. Good guess.
Yeah, he might think the king high is good. He's done nothing to find out where he stands.
65?
Antonio.
Don't think I have a choice, sir.
Because Rasmussen really could have absolutely nothing. It's not like he's called since cards have come down. There's been no clue that he has anything. That's fair enough to call here.
Antonio
shows
calls.
The full house.
Full house. Henrik what? Shows pocket fives, made a full house on the river.
Nice
stick
hand.
Shows pocket
we need to balance
fives.
The tables, and Henrik would
Antonio's
be
analysis was right, though. When he said he've either got 8-9 or queen 10, what he means is he've either got a big hand or no hand. He just didn't anticipate it was that big. He thought the straight, not the house.
You'll notice Henrik Wimmer's leaving our featured table. We need to balance the tables. We're down to 21. We've lost Claudio Pagano. Luca's dad has been knocked out by Dennis Carlo. His ace four, no match to Carlo's ace queen. A queen on the flop, an ace on the turn. It's all over. He's out in 22nd place, taking home just over 46,000 euros. And Luca looking devastated on behalf of his dad. So only one Pagano left in the tournament now, but he's got every chance of taking the title because Luca's a bit of an EPT legend. Sixth in the all-time EPT rankings list, so he'll certainly go top if he wins the title here in Monte Carlo.
Don't even think about it.
Oh, me? Stig saying, I'm in the big blind.
You only do it because I'm in the blind.
Don't come after me.
Let me tell you this, it means he's got a hand. This kind of talk from the big blind.
Scared me.
Yeah. He should have something. He's got at least a pair of eights.
You know, I play 2-7.
Listen to him. Chirp, chirp, chirp. There's a big hand there.
Now,
I'm going to feel like a real idiot if it comes around. He's got 6-3.
Antonio's just limped with the pocket queens.
Well, there we call.
Oh, come on, let me make one move.
And that means
oh, we hadn't actually looked yet. All right, take it all back.
Ace 10.
He just 100%. Wants to get in another pot with Antonio. Look, he's so jealous of the chip lead. That shirt was white when he started.
Antonio just limped with the queens in first position. He's setting a trap here for Rasmussen.
But that's what you're supposed to do. A first position limp is meant to be a big hand. We've seen people do it with Jack 9, Jack 10. It's supposed to indicate strength.
Will Rasmussen read that?
He may just call, but it's a funny hand to go into a four-way pot with. Oh.
Raise all in.
That is just enormous. I don't really understand. He's put in, what, 700,000? Why so big? Why so much?
Call.
And call. Antonio calls.
Yeah, the others will get out of the way.
It's about Valerie 700,000 times 2. Antonio shows
three
pocket deuce. Queens.
You think?
And Rasmussen
and shows ace
also,
of diamonds,
whoops,
ten
I fell into a bit of a trap there.
With ace 10.
Oh, that was
yeah,
a mistake.
Yeah, you see, a massive chip leader has limped under the gun. You don't put 700,000 in. Bump it up 100,000, see what happens. Or
okay,
just call.
Let's
no, we're just calling.
Well, he could have seen a free flop. There'd been no raise there. He was in the big blind.
Up comes. 7, 3, 4.
Well, Rasmussen so no is on the verge of being eliminated now.
Ace to stay in the tournament. Queens are in the lead for Antonio. And here is the turn.
He knows he's played this badly.
Yeah.
But he gets lucky on the turn. He hits his ace.
Now Steve has a pair of aces.
Look at the
only
faces
the
of the crowd. They're actually
the
shocked by the sight of that ace.
And here's the last card.
Antonio
it's
does not get a
sorry,
queen
Steve
on the river.
Hey, sorry.
Oh, don't say sorry.
No, sorry.
Don't say sorry.
You didn't have a hand.
You're not sorry. You must never say sorry, James. You can say unlucky, but you can't say because he isn't sorry. He wouldn't prefer to be walking away out of the tournament, would he? He's delighted. I mean, I'm sure he means well, but sorry is not a good word to say when you win a big pot of someone in that way.
And that is an example of a player playing a hand badly and getting lucky.
Take yourself home.
Antonio Esfandiari set the trap there. He's a very experienced player. as I say, known as the magician because he does magic tricks when he's not at the table. That wouldn't be allowed. So the blinds have gone up. 6 and 12,000 now. Running ante remains 1,000. Remember, every player posts the ante.
With 2,000 antes is the next level.
Thank you, sir.
Action has been folded around to the Russian player at the table. Valery Ilikian, okay, not going to play 6-9 of diamonds.
He passes, the two
so just the blinds left now.
They're not going to get involved again, are they? Jeez, amazing. The blinds weren't even 6-12. He put in 700,000 before the flop.
I think we've concluded it was not a great play.
No, well, now he's got A3. What's he going to bet, a million?
Stick calls.
Look at these two. Get a room.
I think a cage might be more appropriate so we can see some scrapping.
Antonio raises 40 more.
Well, now Rasmussen must re-raise. He's absolutely mandatory. He's limped in with the ace. He can't call and play this kind of hand out of position against such a great player as Antonio.
I knew that move would come. Now the problem is, who had the best hand?
What he's talking about, surely he limped hoping for a raise to come over the top of it. There's only two of them.
What's he left?
What's he got left? About 950,000? What is he asking that question for? Not really relevant against that kind of chip stack. Of course, it's Rasmussen who's got the chip lead now.
Stig re-raises.
Yeah, well, he's finally managed to do the right thing.
How much more?
Looks like about 100 more. 110 more.
Esfandiari knows that he can outplay this guy. He actually knows it after cards.
Yes.
He's desperate to be able to afford to make this call and outplay him. Or possibly even raise again if he senses weakness. But he knows that one of his strengths at this point in the tournament is that he's got position against the chip leader. And he's a better player. So he wants to play pots like this.
Just checking how much he's still got. How much he'd have to invest as a percentage to make this call, to see a flop, and as you say, hopefully outplay his opponent.
But I also think that he might raise again. I think he might. I think all that speech play from Rasmussen, he knows it's not a huge hand, he might try and push him off it. Which would be very gutsy.
You are tough, my friend.
Called it, Vicky.
Antonio re-raises.
There's the re-raise.
230 more than that.
Yeah, that's great. And look at the difference with the speech play. When Rasmussen was giving it all of that to as the best hand, it was a little bit too genuine. Whereas Antonio's is completely a performance. Ah, oh, you're tough. What the hell? He's got five high.
And if you couldn't see the whole cards, if you were just reading the body language, you would think that Antonio does have the best hand.
Absolutely, but this is a man, you know, with years behind him of going on stage and sawing women in half and releasing doves out of handkerchiefs. You know, and that was patter. All right, what the hell? It's great stuff. Rasmussen's going to throw the hand away, and it's a well-deserved win for Antonio. Pass quicker next time. Shows the ace as well.
Stick folds, and Antonio wins the pot.
Always a mistake.
I promise you
which
that.
Which card did you show?
An
ace.
My turn to show you. What?
Two jacks.
He had nothing.
Two jacks.
He
Two jacks, 4-5, one of the two.
Well, a bit of revenge for Antonio after that bad beat he took when he came up against Dig Top Rasmussen the last time. Action continues here in Monte Carlo after the break. It's the grand final of Season 4 of the EPT. Welcome back to the European Poker Tour as night falls here in Monte Carlo with 19 players remaining in the tournament. And we're watching these guys at our feature table right now. Those are the blinds. Every player posting the ante of 1,000 as well.
Yeah, I think I better do that.
Action is on Antonio Esfandiari, who's raising again.
Antonio raises to 38,000.
Ace 10 offsuit.
Eric folds, Maxime folds.
Been folded around.
Look at this little fella.
Sorry, Oivet folds.
This is Maxime Villemure. He's from Canada.
Oh, pop it. He can't be more than 8 years old.
He's 19, I'll have you know.
Stop it.
He's been carded.
Maxime re-raises.
Re-raising Antonio Esfandiari. Now, there's a big hand for Valery Elikian.
Well, this is a shame for little Just William over there, because it's a good play against Esfandiari, who might throw away the ace-10. It's very unfortunate that this Russian mobster's behind him with the ace-king. I'm not saying he's actually a mobster. That would be libelous.
Yes, the EPT disassociates itself from any humorous remarks Victoria Corrin may be making right now.
It's how much more to me?
Yeah, never mind it's how much more to me. Those hands are going in the muck.
66.
Antonio's card's unplayable in this spot.
Interesting that Valery chose to just call the re-raise, though. He didn't raise it again.
Yeah, he could have raised again there, and it might have looked like a squeeze play, and he'd have got action from one of these. He could have done that.
As it stands, though, he will get to play the hand in position. He is sitting on the button.
Yeah, well, he will if there's no further action. But imagine that Villemure's actually got the hand he's representing, which would be two jacks, two queens. Now he's not going to pass for a re-raise, so Elikian would rather see the flop before making a decision. That's okay. The only argument against it is that he's only got
Antonio calls
about 358,000 in total, Elikian, so he's kind of pot committed now.
We didn't expect that, though. Antonio called Maxime's re-raise, so we are three-way.
Yeah, I didn't expect that from Antonio, and I don't think he should have
flop
called there.
Flop is 9 of clubs, 7 of spades, 4 of diamonds.
What's a nothing flop, though?
Now, this is the problem for Elikian. I think for his remaining chips, he can't afford to pass. He doesn't know he's got the best hand. So maybe it would have been better for him to re-raise pre-flop, because he shouldn't be backing out anyway.
Antonio.
Antonio bets 150,000.
He's betting 150,000.
And now it's uncomfortable for Villemure, because there's somebody lurking behind him with an unknown hand. His instincts are right against the magician. But he can't legislate for Elikian. Who now, let me just say this, should not pass. Of course he thinks he's got the worst of it.
Yeah.
But there's just too much money in the pot and too few chips left in front of him to throw this away. And it's kind of a disrespectful bet from Esfandiari, because Esfandiari knows that a really top player could not pass for the chips left in front of him, for the chips in the pot. The fact that he thinks Elikian could pass or has a worse hand than Ace-10.
Valery folds.
Yeah, he's not showing the guy much respect, and he's right not to.
Antonio representing on that board.
Now we're talking.
And the curtains open in the Salle des Etoiles, revealing the beautiful Monte Carlo skyline.
More particularly revealing the beautiful smoking terrace at the back, where I spent most of the tournament.
That's why you got blinded off. This really is the most glamorous stop on the EPT, no shadow of a doubt.
Yeah, it's a really beautiful spot. That terrace is amazing. Just the bay and the
Valery and Walid have got the
gleam of the watches of the millionaires sailing below it.
Antonio folds.
And the blinds have gone up. 8 and 16,000 now.
Eric passes.
I wish Eric Liu would play more hands. I want to see more of them.
Problem is, if you get dealt garbage...
Ovid raises two.
There's action before you. There's not much he can do.
No, but you say that. That last hand with Antonio was a sign that the cards are completely irrelevant. It was a three-way pot. Antonio actually had the second best hand, but for the position, it was really the third best. Didn't matter. He played to win it anyway.
Well, the raise here has come from Øyvind Riesen with the A7, and Habib is incredibly short stacked. Is that all he's got left?
He's only got about 100,000.
Stack of brown 5,000 chips. They go across the line.
I got a call.
It's a compulsory call for Riesen.
Yeah, I don't know quite how Habib got down that low, but you've got to figure that he'd have had better chances to put all his chips in than this one.
Well, at least his 8 and his 10 alive. He's got a 43% chance.
He's all in, so he needs to hit a hand or he will be out in 19th place.
But he is the player at risk here.
Give me a 10.
Riesen's hand holds up.
Good.
We lose another player.
Flop is queen, queen, jack.
Can hit a few nines now.
Gut shot, straight draw, so he needs a 9, 10, or 8.
9 for the straight, an 8 or a 10 for a pair.
Ooh.
Turn is a king.
Lots of outs now.
Now he needs an ace, a 10 won't do him any good. There are three hearts, but nobody has a heart that won't change anything. River card, please, Teresa.
A river.
It's a 5.
It's a blank. The ace high holds up.
Thank you.
And Walid Bou Habib is our 19th place finisher.
Thank you.
Down to 18 players.
Good luck.
He shakes the hands of his opponents and goes off to the cage to collect his winnings.
Poor old Habib. He said he was liable to call too much and he did it anyway.
Meanwhile, on our outer tables, that is our current chip leader, Robin Keston, raking in another pot. He's got over 1.4 million now, so he's overtaken both Antonio Esfandiari and Stig Top Rasmussen, who are at our feature table.
Okay, we have a single big blind. Stig has it.
Speaking of Antonio, he's entering another pot here with a raise.
37,000.
Yeah, I like this. He's mixing it up. When he had two queens under the gun, he just limped in. Now he's raising. Variety in his game. He's playing really well.
They're playing snap.
He re-raises to 150. Maxime folds.
So is anyone going to get caught up in the middle of these two?
Well, they've both got big chips, Riesen and Esfandiari.
Big passes, it's back to Antonio.
Antonio's back to over a million. Riesen's got about 900,000. So, you know, if either of them had fewer chips, I think it would get shoveled all in pre-flop. Yeah. That doesn't need to happen here.
How much you had there? 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9. You have a big hand?
Yeah, it is, but yours is big as well.
Maybe he is going to raise now. I'm thinking he's giving it the patter again. He might be going to raise. He might think, well...
Something tells me you have a monster.
Well, there's only two hands he's really worried about. Aces and kings.
Oh, no, that's not true. It's not true, because this guy's got chips that can really damage him. If he had 200,000, there's only two hands he's worried about. But with somebody who's got nearly a million, he's worried about any pair. He's worried about putting a lot of chips in, getting called, missing the flop, and being really crippled. One thing you don't want to do when you're the chip leader on the table is get involved in a huge pot with the second chip leader that you might lose. You want to pick off the short stacks, bully the medium stacks.
I don't know, something just doesn't feel right.
He's mucking it.
Take it.
And you know that's really okay. Of the options available, that's not a bad play at all.
I mucked ace king for you.
Yeah, right.
You want a bet?
He doesn't lie.
Yeah, I think he lies. I don't want to bet it, but I think you're lying.
Ace king.
He's telling the truth.
No.
Big blind.
Either really dumb or really smart. One of those two.
No, you didn't have ace king.
What?
He did.
No, I don't think you had ace king.
He did.
I swear.
Look, well, those two continue to bicker. I can tell you we're down to 16 players now. Something's happened on the outer tables. Johnny Lodden is our 17th place finisher. He's been knocked out by Henrik Gwinner. Lodden had pocket eight. Gwinner ace jack. It was a race, almost 50-50 with five cards to come. There's an ace on the flop. No eight on the turn. No eight on the river. Johnny Lodden, gutted. So these are the final 16 players still in contention here in Monte Carlo. Luca Pagano of Team PokerStars Pro still up there. And in the top half of the table, we see Robin Keston has the chip lead, but there are three players close behind him. Four, in fact, including Antonio the Magician Esfandiari and Stigtot Rasmussen. So 16 players, that means another redraw. It means we'll have a new feature table for you next time. Some great faces still in, including Luca Pagano, Joe Hashem, and of course, Antonio Esfandiari. So next time, we'll see these last 16 fighting it out for their seat at the final table. Don't miss the action here on the European Poker Tour.